Hey, YouTubers, it's me, Lonnie Clark. I apologize for putting up a video that had no sound. I guess I had the mute button on the whole time. I actually discovered that when I plug in my microphone, it automatically mutes. So I'm going to redo this. And I want to say thank you. I am grateful that there's some millennials. One of the messages that let me know this thing was blank was one of the millennials. They said the millennials are listening to this, which is awesome because we need millennials to actually engage in this. It is your future, and it is you who are being contaminated. And in that vein, please, if you're listening to this today on Friday, March 10th, go out and find a way to make public, bring out a sign that says Fukushima is still ongoing. We are being poisoned nonstop, folks. So what I'm going to do is reread this, the whole last bit that I mangled. I went back and listened to try to figure out where I was, and oh my gosh, I was so tired the other night. I mangled Gofman's whole thing, so it probably confused all you guys. So I'm going to continue. I am going to read this. And guess what? As it turns out, we're almost done. We're very, very close. I don't think I'll read the full 20 minutes like I did last night, but I think I'll read a good portion of it. I'm going to pick this back up. And he's in conversation. The subtitle is Ethics in Human Radiation Experiments. And this is Gofman talking. Yes. I consider the things like the injections of plutonium immoral. You'll get a copy of that video. I don't have an extra copy. I can show it to you today if you want to see it. I'll see that you get a copy of the thing that I did on 60 Minutes Australia. It was a matter of very, very deep personal significance. The 18 people who got the plutonium were chosen because they were believed not to have a long life expectancy. I have for a long time as a physician known that the dumbest thing a doctor can do is to decide the life expectancy of someone else. The Eileen Welsom story shows you that some of those people lived 25 years. It was a personal experience which was on that tape, and I'll tell it to you briefly. Helen, my wife, was an intern in pediatrics at the time. This young boy was brought over from Australia to become one of the 18. Any child that was brought into UC Hospital had to go through the pediatrics admission service. Helen worked this child up on his admission physical. She didn't remember it, but they showed it to me in some of the documents that came out from Hazel's office. I was working with 60 Minutes, with the 60 Minutes Australia group. And by Hazel, he means Hazel O'Leary, who was at the time the Department of Energy Secretary. That was 1946 when this child was here. I must have been marching around the halls when that kid was in the hospital because I was in my senior clerkship and getting ready to start my internship. In a year after that child was here at UC, my son was born. Helen didn't do well after the delivery. He was a little premature and he came along okay. She got sick. It was just a low-grade fever and nothing else showing. Finally, after a couple of months, she had some tenderness on one side of her abdomen. I went in to see her OBGYN, Dr. Overstreet, who thought she should be operated on, that she might have an ovarian cyst. He did operate on her. She had an ovarian abscess. Excuse me. I'm going to read that again. He thought she might have an ovarian abscess. He did operate on her. She had an ovarian abscess, and they spilled some of the abscess material. I'm telling you, people, stay away from these doctors. She'd have done a million times better if she'd had a midwife. American Murder Association, these fuckers. Excuse me. Excuse my language. When they got out of surgery, her temperature skyrocketed. She was very sick. That was in 1947. She was in the hospital and they analyzed the organs that came out of the ovarian abscess. It turned out to be called bacteroides funduliformis. Bacteroides funduliformis. It's an organism that's common in us. Almost never pathogenic. It's in the bowel. Almost never hurts anybody unless you get an infection with it. Professor Kerr, the one I told you later, who later criticized me for doing things without getting permission, was brought into her case because she was going downhill very rapidly. He called Chester Kiefer, who had been the expert during World War II on U.S. soldiers with infectious diseases. He told him about it and asked what we should do. He said, penicillin, 500,000 units is the only thing they know. They're about 95 to 98% fatal. She already had 500,000 units of penicillin, and it didn't work. Henry Brainerd, the infectious disease headman, had no idea. I had no idea. Just watching her go downhill. They had gone down to about 80. She had gone down to about 80 pounds. Her temperature was about 104 degrees Fahrenheit. That's 40 degrees Celsius. It was just a matter of time. She was an ideal candidate for a plutonium injection. Here is a woman who is about to die, has maybe a couple of weeks to live. You can get all your data. In that year, one of the 18 was injected in that hospital. This was an ideal candidate for plutonium injections, a patient with a limited life expectancy. Gourley, did you know of the plutonium injections at the time? Gofman, I had no idea. I'm just telling you that. Gourley, right. Gofman, I have a moral principle on this thing. We were just watching her die. Jack Frenkel was a resident in pathology. He recently retired from the University of Kansas. You know what's really sad is these people, there are things and herbs that you can do to heal these gut bacteria, and these stupid fuckers know nothing about it. They really make me mad. Let's continue. I'm sorry. He was a pathology professor and came up to me and said, I checked Helen's organisms in the lab. 500,000 units of penicillin won't touch her. He said, 5 million might. Now remember, they think 500,000 will kill her. Now you have to understand, in those days, a million units of penicillin was regardless as astronomical. He said he thought 5 million might help. We quickly went to Henry Brainerd and Professor Kerr and told them about this testing done on her organism. They both agreed, let's get the 5 million units. Jack said that might not touch her. I said, well, what about 10 million? And they agreed to that. Nobody received 5 million in that hospital. I don't think anybody had ever had a million. But Professor Kerr and Henry Brainerd agreed that Helen ought to be tried on 10 million units a day. I promptly went down to the pharmacy and tried to arrange it. They said 10 million units a day. We don't have 10 million units in the hospital. That was a little discouraging. Professor Kerr, to his everlasting credit, called Dr. Robert Cutter, who was the head of Cutter Lab, one of the biggest manufacturers of penicillins. Dr. Robert Cutter gave us a gift of 100 million units of penicillin. 100 million, enough for 10 days. I went over to Berkeley to pick it up, and we came back. The penicillin wasn't that pure in those days. To get 10 million units into a single injection, you had to combine a lot of vials into it. It was a fairly big mass. I finally put some procaine in it to try to deaden the pain. Helen didn't have much buttocks left to put an injection into her. Her temperature was about 40 degrees Celsius, which is 104. She was just out of it, sick. Gave her the first 10 million units that day. By the next morning, her temperature was normal. By the 10th day, she went home. She was better. She didn't die from the bacterioids. One guy, Jack Frenkel, turned medicine on its head. He took a fatal disease and, on his own initiative, tried something that nobody suggested, and it worked. These narrow-minded, AMA, backward-thinking people just drive me crazy. Oh, my God. Back to our little bit of a story. Gourley. So, it was a human experiment that worked. Gofman. It was a human experiment that worked. There was a guy that said, Listen, if you don't, if you're so goddamn smart, don't go playing God and telling people that they don't have much time to live and give them plutonium injections when something can turn them around in 3 days. Maybe they have a lifetime to live. In that same period, the one whose daughter was Elmarine, what was his name? Elmer Callan? Cal-3? Goffman. Cal-2. Cal-2 was the little boy from Australia, Simeon Shaw, and the program was called The Betrayal of Simeon Shaw. It seems that Helen could have been one of the people given the injection because she didn't have any lifespan left. So it reminded me of how immoral it would be for somebody to give her an injection of plutonium before Jack Frenkel turned things on its head. Gourley. You know the players who were involved in that. You know Joe Hamilton, Dr. Stone. You know Lobeer. You probably know Dr. Bellamy. Goffman. Bellamy? I didn't know. I don't know. But I know, I sure knew all the others. I'm sitting here making up my own sentences, folks. Okay, Hefner. You weren't there, and so this is an unfair question, but how could they do it? Goffman. Well, I think what I said earlier about Lobeer and Stone coming out of an era of 30 years or so, where they just didn't think about the hazard of plutonium. They should have thought about it because they knew about radon. The idea of putting those people in the positions where they were the favorite children of the era. Automatic checkbook, great prestige, we're saving the world. We can't be wrong. You know what I think, Lori. One of those things you'll see in situations like that is at one level down or 2 levels down from the top. Most people try to think what they would like to have at the top. Do all these things that they think their bosses would want. This is a bad transcription, I think. I think maybe they could have thought, well, look, we're going to prove that radiation isn't that harmful. There was almost a mantra. Radiation can't be that harmful. Radiation isn't that harmful. They're still singing that mantra today, and still yet today. Egan O'Connor and I discussed that was a great idea. The issue of what it takes for people to live with themselves. We think about that a lot. She believes that if you don't have a rationalization for yourself, that they cannot do these things. They have to have a rationalization. I sometimes think that some of them are evil, anyways. They don't need a rationalization, but she thinks they do. Sometimes it's pretty hard to see that rationalization. I don't know. I think that maybe Joe was just a simple guy. He sure wasn't a malevolent person. Beer Hamilton just wasn't. Stone, I guess I have to say Stone and Bert Lobeer really didn't think they were harming anybody. I think they were buying the short life expectancy thing. I don't think Lewis Hempelman was malevolent. I don't know Stafford Warren well. Surely Shields Warren was not malevolent in character, a fine man. I think that overblown idea about their importance almost negated having to think, we couldn't be wrong. We're just doing things that are needed. I hear of people talking, it's because of the Cold War. I listened to it in the congressional hearings where Markey was saying, Elmarine, you should think of your father as a war hero in the Cold War. I groaned when I say this. What the hell is Markey talking about? The Cold War didn't require any of this stuff. That's baloney, just real baloney. I don't think it required anything. I think it just gave these people a checkbook and it gave them a little wooden block with a rubber piece on it that said secret, and they could just stamp a thing, and the whole world was precluded from seeing what was on your piece of paper. Think of that power. I think people do crazy things when they're obsessed with power. Hefner. So the whole rationale that we did it to understand worker safety? Goffman. Lori, Let me tell you about worker safety. Do you know the story about Eisenbud and the uranium miners? Hefner. About the uranium miners? Go ahead and tell me, though. Gofman. Well, in 1947, the AEC was getting off the ground. Merrill Eisenbud was a young health physicist working in the New York operations office of the AEC. He and his boss, a fellow by the name of Wolf, decided to look over the situation in the uranium mines in the West. They came here and found out that the mines were not that safe, not ventilated adequately. Nobody had informed either the miners nor the mine operators of what the probable consequences would be. Now that's 20 years after the dial painters, so we knew what alpha particles could do. It's 10 and 20 years later, both a decade of the 20s and 30s where they knew about the European mine workers. So the idea of what alpha particles could do was well known. Merrill Eisenbud comes back from the trip and he writes up a memo to the AEC saying, Gourley interrupts and says, what was that year? Gofman, 1947. If we don't do something about those mines, this is in quote, if we don't do something about those mines, we're going to have a lung cancer epidemic. It's going to be larger than they had in Europe. Their answer was to move Merrill Eisenbud to a different division. The Washington office took over handling it. They never informed the miners nor the mine operators. We did have a lung epidemic. And you ask if they care about this worker's safety? Hefner. We also paid them a differential to make sure they went into the mines. Gofman, we did? I didn't know about that. Hefner, we paid them extra. Gofman. I think that to say an organization that knowingly was sending some men to their deaths, and you can tell me that they cared about workers' safety? Gourley. But now earlier you said in 1945 with the war going on, you would gladly assume the risk for what you did. Now Eisenbud, his big thing was Project Sunshine, right? Gofman, he may very well have been a big wheel in Sunshine. I don't know. He's not an opponent of atomic energy. He probably doesn't like me. I was wondering if there was some overlap between his... This is Gourley asking. I'm wondering if there's some overlap between his studies on strontium and the fallout and the work done at Livermore. Gofman, which work at Livermore? Gourley, the biology and medicine, Gofman, that I headed? The whole thing on Project Sunshine was like a decade before us. Gourley, so did you review that? Gofman, yes, we reviewed those things. That was part of the story. It wasn't a big deal, but we did review it. There were no good studies out of Project Sunshine of people being exposed to various levels of the following of curve of effects. That's what was needed. You had Project Sunshine that showed everybody was getting strontium into their teeth and bones, but nobody was showing they were being hurt. Hiroshima gives us a summary of people exposed at various doses, and you find that a dose response that's positive. That's pretty definitive. Sunshine didn't do that. Hefner, that covers it for me. Is there anything else you'd like to add? Wow. So she cuts it off right as he starts telling her that Project Sunshine was a rigged deal. Gofman, well, I gave you those sheets. Hefner, we will place them in the office. Gofman, you got the sheets? Hefner, we got the sheets and I'll try to get the transcript, the one tape you talked to us about. Gofman, let's see. There's the one that I have. I just talked to CNN's video and it has 10 minutes of the interview, which lasted 3 days. They used 3 minutes, but the hour are the tapes of 60 Minutes Australia. I need to get some more copies. I don't have any extras. Well, I'll get a copy. That will be about an hour talking about the mortality of plutonium injections, and I'll get you a copy. The story of Helen Gofman and Jack Frankel is on that tape. Tapes are like those. Had a light bulb blow up in the middle of things. Just was strictly uncut, which is too. just was strictly uncut, which that is too. I want to get you a copy of Irreverie to wherever you are so you can read about my Nuremberg trial idea. Gourley, I'd like a copy of that. And with that, we're at the end. We're beginning. There's a message from John Gofman, supplement to the oral history of John W. Gofman. I am very interested in reading his supplement. So thank you guys for making your comments. Oh dear, there's my glasses. For making the comments on the video today. I'll upload this right now and get back to work, and then I'll finish this up tonight and we'll be a done deal. Put your courage feet on, you guys. Very, very, very important that we lean into this and demand like this, pulling the curtains back. We need to let the light in. It's extremely important. We need answers. And we need to free the scientists from corporate greed. That's going to be my sign I'm going to make out. Free the scientists from corporate greed. Put your courage feet on, you guys. Ciao.